for each of you who spoke. I'm really grateful. I'm grateful and I am happy that I have represented myself to you in the way in which my ancestors would be proud. And if you could stand and speak words from the heart. I think leadership is something sacred. And not to be taken for granted. I also want to recognize my colleagues who are here. Senator Harrigan, Senator Blyden was in the back, and I saw some of the representatives of Senator Ford. And Senator Graham told me he would come, but he had to take his son to college. So for those who couldn't make it, I'm sure they're here with us in spirit as well. I want to acknowledge my mother, because she would pray. And she was like, no way, no matter what. And my mom's birthday was the 12th of August, and my birthday was the 7th of August. And my first birthday gift that I got was about three weeks ago. I took my mom to a wedding. Her great nephew was getting married out at Morningstar. And I dressed partially at the house. So I didn't realize, maybe about 2 weeks later, I left my sandals in the room, in her bedroom. And so when I went back, I was like, you see my sandals? And she brought them out and she said, they don't look different. So I said, yes, they're browner. She had polished them. Clean them. That's the nature of my mother. She's planted lime trees because I can't drink tea without lime. And plantain and bananas that I eat fresh from the ground in Hannah's Retreat. So these are the things that my mother gives me. Those are the small things, gifts that may appear small, but things that I really treasure. And she made 81 on the 12th of August. So I'm really happy to have her here with us. So thank you, each endorser. Thank you so much. I take your trust and the expressions of sincerity, I take them to heart, and I'm gratified by you. So when last we did this in 2014, I had a great time telling you of my accomplishments, the first term, urging you on to my re-election. The first thing, when all that unravels is new. Huh? This time though, whenever I sat down to prepare these remarks, I got stuck. I wanted to give you a blow by blow of this term. Tell you each time I was excited, each time I was disappointed, each time I learned a thing that I might not have wanted to know. But each time I got stuck and the words just would not come home to me. I forced myself to construct paragraphs about the weapons registry bill, which I introduced in the first term in 2015, but which I later got all my colleagues to co-sponsor this term, and which finally is now law, having been signed into effect by Governor Kenneth Mann. It is not that this bill is not important. It is, because it paves the way for greater control of weapons coming into our ports. It provides a different level of law enforcement presence at our ports. and it gives prosecutors another opportunity to level charges against offenders, charges that will attach as soon as you leave the port without completing the registration requirement. I wrote as well about my proposal to create a federal lands impact tax credit for our tax-burdened residents. A new exemption which would reflect how these lands, these federally owned lands on these islands, reduce the tax base, result in less housing, less land for housing and development, more costly land, higher taxes. This would bring particular relief to St. Johnians, who have been crying out for years about this and other realities of life on their tiny island, whose acreage the federal government claims more than 60%. And a federal income, federal impact lands credit would give a credit to homesteaders in the percentage that the federal government owns land on that particular island. Even though I wrote that, I still was stuck. This continued late into the evening, last evening, when I forced myself to sit at my desk, literally trying to command the words to flow. The struggle continued up until about 8:45 p.m., when finally I decided to leave the legislature building and finish the task at home. By now, you probably know what I encountered as I came out the main entrance of the building. A crime scene. Just across the street at the fire station. Police cars flashing blue. The all too familiar yellow tape screaming, "Do not cross," crime scene. A gathering crowd of onlookers, a palpable sadness, the sounds of a woman sobbing, audible sounds, even where she comforted a small child in her arms. The security guard walked up behind me to tell me that about 7:45, he had heard a singular shot, then moved instinctively to cover himself before looking across the street in the direction of the sound to see a man already slumped over. A firefighter, who we now know to be Gregory Benson Lewis. God rest his soul. God bring comfort to the members of his family. The security guard and I chatted for a while about the singular shot, about the legislature's cameras facing the street, and whether there might be anything in the footage that could help in an investigation. And as he spoke, my mind wandered to the killings of the two police officers maybe 2 weeks before, and then to Bria Evans, the young girl cut down in her glorious prime, but a whole world is still reaching out to her. And all the young men, 23 years of age and less and more, who have all left the earth, which needed them for a purpose. That we will know. which needed them for a purpose that we would now never have. And all this came down upon me so that I could realize that today, that this evening, requires a different type of conversation. That this was not a time simply to boast of accomplishments or to demean others in any way, but rather to reflect on leadership and the qualities of the heart and the soul. I'm glad that Dr. Simmons started a conversation about this building and what it meant to her, means to her. Because I love this town. I have loved this town for the whole time that I have known it. When my parents first brought me here in 1968, and when we came down this same street, just higher up, to places like Hayes Department Store, where they bought my first school uniforms, the brown and beige of the Seventh-day Adventist School, then located on 7th-day Street. All places like La Gracia, where my mother, the seamstress, bought fabric and thread to make our stylish carnival shirts, or Daniel's Variety Store, just across the street where you could find any manner of trinket. Not even 5 minutes from here was one of the places where we lived, Curacao Garden, number 9, from which I walked at morning times to either Lockett Bakery, down at Bakery Square, or to any of the other bakeries in Savan to buy freshly baked bread. St. Thomas was different then. Bustling, a lot of activity. And unlike the quaint Sandy Point St. Kitts of my memory, beneath the mountains where my grandfather planted corn and peanuts and watermelons and peppers, and where I felt surrounded by the rapturous green of cane fields, stretching to the limits of my vision. When I say St. Thomas was different, I don't mean simply that we still lived as a village, that we still had a sense of community, that people still looked out for one another, that we could still correct one another's children. This was true. But I always remember the distinct feeling that I did not belong. For although I loved this town, although we had had the good fortune of welcoming neighbors and the company of loving Virgin Islanders, like Miss Ruth Lenhardt, who introduced me to Kalaloo, I still existed as an outsider, belonging to the group of those people who had come here to take jobs, who came to bring down this place and not to build it up, the aliens, the ILOs, all those names. I can say the words now because they do not hurt anymore. In 48 years, they have lost the sting and the love that has been shown me has prevailed. It took me a long time to call St. Thomas home. But once I did, then the gloves were off. Don't come to me if you do not wish to speak well of St. Thomas. I will not have it. Because this island has done not one single thing to people other than to lift them up. For decades, this island was the rising tide that lifted all ships. The testimony to that is all over the Caribbean, and we must remember this. It is funny that my colleagues here can tell you that whenever my Crucian counterparts get ready to say something about St. Thomas, I am the one they look at, from whom they expect a defense. they often joke, look at Roach's face, you can't say none about St. Thomas for heat. One even got so upset with me that he proclaimed that I should remember that he is more a St. Thomian than me, because even though he was born in St. Croix, his father was born in St. Thomas. I told him he could say whatever he wants. I am long past the point where anybody has to give me permission to love this island and the people of it, whether I was born here or not. And you know what? St. Thomas, St. Thomians, St. Johnians have loved me back.